Good evening, everybody. I'm John Gilhooley, director of Wigmore Hall, and it's my great pleasure to welcome online audiences from across the world to tonight's live broadcast. This evening, David Bates and La Nuova Musica will be joined by the acclaimed soprano Lucy Crowe for works by Vivaldi and Handel, as well as the London premiere of Nico Muhly's Land in an Isle. Tonight's performance is part of Wigmore Hall's early music series, which showcases some of the world's finest ensembles and now includes over 50 concerts every season. Stay tuned at the interval for a special interview with David Bates and Lucy Crowe, who spoke to us earlier during rehearsals. But now, please welcome to the stage David Bates and La Nuova Musica to begin this evening's concert.
Thank you. Thank you. Hello, my name is Lucy Crowe and I'm the soprano singing tonight.
And I'm David Bates. I'm the conductor of La Nuova Musica and great friends with Lucy. And we met 20 years ago.
Yeah, a long time ago.
Wretched. and we've been best friends ever since.
Yeah.
And this is our fourth recital here at Wigmore.
But it's our first solo recital, isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
We've done four operas, I think, here. Three operas.
Three operas here.
And this has got operatic repertoire in it, but it's also got some sacred stuff.
Yeah.
By Vivaldi and Handel. And we've got this wonderful new commission by Nico Muli. How do you like it?
I love it. We were discussing earlier, though, it was quite hard for me to learn. I think when you get a new piece that's never been performed before, to sit at the piano and bash out the notes, I'm not a wonderful pianist, as you know, but to sit and learn your notes can be okay, but then you hear the sound world of the orchestra when you get together with orchestra for first time, and sometimes it can really throw you. So I did find it quite difficult, but once, it's like when I learnt Sophie and Der Rosenkavalier, Strauss, that was very hard to learn, but as soon as you've learnt it, it's almost like it just slots in and it stays there.
Yeah, we did it yesterday rehearsing.
Yeah.
Because we'd premiered it in Lichfield about...
In July, wasn't it?
Yeah, 3 or 4 months ago.
Yeah.
And it was amazing what had stayed with it, because it was the same orchestra, mainly the same orchestra,
yes.
And it had all stayed there, and so we were able to build on that and find new colours and...
Definitely, yeah.
Explore it more. Yeah, it's a wonderful piece. It's sort of, when I asked Nico to write it, I said that it would sit in the programme alongside Vivaldi and Handel.
Mm-hmm.
And I said specifically that it would be great if we could have something that, you know, Vivaldi, Venice, of course, he's spent most of his life there, all of his life there. It was obviously the gateway to the East and North Africa, and so all this, the spice world and mm-hmm. the Orientalism and that sort of thing. And so I said, could you somehow incorporate that into the piece? And of course, the best bit is when you sing "So Sweet an Odour."
Yes,
came out of the tomb of St.
Yes.
Mark.
It is a very beautiful piece, and it's lovely to be able to sing slightly differently. So all the Baroque music we've got tonight we've got fireworks, we've got beauty, high-lying lines, and it's a joy to sing. But actually, this is a great contrast, sound world-wise, but also vocally. I get a little chance to croon occasionally.
You do, when you're not with me in L&M, you do, as you say, Strauss, Mozart, all the Baroque stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Have you done much contemporary stuff?
I haven't done that much. And actually, I really love it. I think I don't shy away from it, but I think you've got to have a lot of time to put in to really learn new pieces like this. And certainly, having two children, I don't have that time at the moment. But I do really enjoy it. And actually, I do love the challenge of learning it as well, because it feels like such a achievement when you get to perform it, and perform it really telling a story.
Do you sing differently when you're singing contemporary stuff, from Baroque stuff to Romantic stuff to classical stuff?
Yes, but it's because of the way it's written, and it's really hard to put into words. Like, we had another commission, Edmund Finnis wrote a beautiful piece, and certainly singing that was quite different to singing this music.
So how do you get into these styles? It can't be magic. I mean, do you learn from recordings coaching?
It's instinctive, and I think it's just given to you from the music. Learning it, singing it, working out what it's trying to say and what sound I need to create for certain bits. I love singing pop music and folk music, and actually with contemporary music, especially the Muli, I find that I'm singing it slightly folky mm-hmm. as well as sort of classical.
So is that going to be our next recital? Folk songs?
Yeah, why not? Brilliant.
I'd quite like to, because certainly at the beginning of the 17th century, loads of all of the folk songs that we know, like the Waily Waily and Raven and all those ones, they were all hugely popular because they all started to be printed with the expansion of printing. They got out into people's homes. So perhaps we should do like a Baroque folk.
With folk?
Yeah, Baroque folk.
I'm in.
Right.
Brilliant.
Oh, well done. That's done.
That sounds good.
Great. So then we've got to think about how does the difference work, or the similarity work, between the secular stuff and the sacred stuff for this programme?
Yeah.
How do you approach that differently, or same?
It's funny, when I hear other people talking about approach, and when people ask me questions like that, I know they're looking for sort of, you know, really interesting, amazing facts. But actually, when you said instinctive, that really is what it is with me. It's instinctive. I'm led by the music and by the text, and what comes out is what I think I feel the music needs, and I don't sort of, well, there's no other,
you don't question
there's no question,
you
no,
trust
exactly,
it.
Exactly. I think you have to as an artist.
Yeah, of course.
I think you have to, otherwise, yeah.
Yeah. Certainly from an historical point of view, all of the sacred singers were singing in the opera houses as well. So for me, there's not a great deal of difference between the sacred and secular stuff in approach.
Certainly spiritually, I think there's a slight difference. I don't believe in God, but I don't know, how do you sum up being spiritual, but singing the sacred music, there is something slightly more intimate possibly about it, but also more expressive in a united sense.
Mm-hmm. I mean, certainly if you look at the art of the period, the sensuality of the sacred is so in your face.
And that's actually lovely, what you get out of me, because often when we're singing or performing the sacred stuff, you're saying, I want it to be sexy and sensual. And it really takes it so much.
There's obviously in Furore, It's about the just anger of God from people that that are misbehaving. And so the way to placate God is in the recit that you have, where it is almost like a love song to try and trying to calm him down, and then you have this amazing sort of almost like a lullaby kind of thing to try and calm him down. But also there's that sensuality is absolutely part of the line as well. I'm sure of it.
Yeah, and actually the ornaments you write are incredibly beautiful and sensual as well, and tricky, some of them. Thank you for that.
Well, they're designed to show you off. You know, that's what they were doing. They wanted their art and their technical expertise to really, you know, bowl people over. So,
well, I hope I do.
You will, of course you will. Good. Okay. Well, good luck.
Thank you very much.
See you there.
Enjoy.
Yeah.
Thank you. you so much, ladies and gentlemen. We do have one more aria for you from Il Trionfo. It's not the same character as Bellezza that you just heard. It's Piacere, pleasure. And she sings Lascia la spina. There's no rose without a thorn.